Good afternoon. I'm Lynn Knoll of Digital Heritage Consulting, homeported in Boston, and very sorry I can't be here in person today. I'm very excited to be a part of this remarkable gathering, and I'd like to tell you about a remarkable woman. Joanna Colcord led a sailor's life and left a collector's legacy. We'll start with a voyage she made around the world at the age of 15 on her father's bark in the China trade. I'll sing you a song, a good song of the sea. Away, Rio! I'll sing you a song if you'll sing it with me. And we're bound for the Rio Grande. And it's away, Rio! Away, Rio! And fare you well, my pretty young girls. And we're bound for the Rio Grande. Our good ship went sailing out over the bar. Away, Rio! We pointed her bow to the southern star, and we're bound for the Rio Grande. And it's away, Rio! Away, Rio! And fare ye well, my pretty young girls, and we're bound for the Rio Grande. And fare ye well, my pretty young girls, and we're bound for the Rio Grande. Way enough! That was a blue water journey Joanna made in 1895 to 97, accompanied by a well-known capstan chantey that she published in 1924. In 1984, Johnny Collins heard me sing that song, clapped me on the shoulder, and said with respect, "Most women shouldn't sing sea shanties." I was 24. It took me many years to respond, "I'm not most women." Neither was Joanna Colcord. She's my hero. So, who was Joanna Colcord? Who were her family and friends? What did she do, and how and why did she do it? What strengths did she bring to her collecting? And where did she struggle? How can we place her in context as an American collector between the First and Second World Wars? How does her collection stand up today in its centennial year? Let's take a look at the first collector of songs of American sailormen. Joanna's network began with a seafaring birthright for over five generations in Searsport, Maine. Her father came from a long line of sea captains, and her mother was also born and raised at sea. Captain and Mrs. Colcord left on their honeymoon voyage the night of their wedding and came home 3 years later with two children. Joanna was born on March 18, 1882, attended by an Australian midwife about 10 miles off the coast of the French penal colony of New Caledonia. She wrote she was grateful her parents did not name her Caledonia. Her birth certificate for place of birth gives latitude and longitude. She goes on to say that just after rounding Cape Horn on the homeward passage, my brother Lincoln arrived in a gale of wind, the ship a leak, and my distracted father having to officiate at his son's birth as well as look after his ship. Joanna and her brother Lincoln, known to the family as Nanny and Linky, took turns accompanying their parents on extended voyages and returning home to Searsport for schooling. The children did lessons on board, and Joanna even took her final exams from Searsport High School in Hong Kong. She had to wait several months to learn whether or not she'd passed. Early voyages were made on the Charlotte A. Littlefield and the Clara McGilvery, but the family's chief memories were made aboard the Bark Harbor and the State of Maine in the China trade. As a merchant mariner, Captain Colcord and his family made many trips around the Horn and the Cape of Good Hope for ports on both sides of the Pacific. This map shows a collection of their voyages from 1882 to 1903. Most of their voyages started from New York or Boston, and many times stopped in the Rio Grande area for a cargo of South American timber. Joanna's next big adventure began at the age of 8, sailing up the River Plate, or Rio Plata, to the port of Rosario in the interior of Argentina, where she contracted dysentery and nearly died. When she had found her sea legs again, she writes of playing with her kitten in the nooks and crannies of a deckload of lumber. Joanna made a lifelong friend and writer and collector Cicely Fox Smith, who wrote stirringly of the long road to travel to Rosario. In his introduction to Songs of American Sailormen, Lincoln Colcord says of his sister that, up to the age of 18, she spent most of her girlhood at sea on board her father's command, sailing on China voyages, and from this experience she acquired, as if by nature, the essential feeling of ships in the sea. Throughout her youth, she lived constantly in an atmosphere of seafaring, in a setting of ocean days, knowing none but the men and women of the sea, seeing nothing but ships and ports about the world, hearing no speech but the nautical vernacular. This is a model of the Bark Harvard, the home of Joanna and Lincoln's childhood. Joanna discovered shanties at an early age. I still recall the thrill of hearing the crew of a British ship lying beside us in Shanghai sing the old chantey, "Goodbye, farewell, goodbye, farewell," as they heaved up anchor, and of comprehending for the first time that this was beautiful and distinctive music. Her life at sea gave Joanna a global network of informants, from her father and his sea captain colleagues to the many shanty singers she acknowledges in her books. She practiced participant observation by nature. Her collection includes songs transcribed from memory, learned from her father and his fellow captains, notated from sailors in the field, and sourced from the many collectors and scholars with whom she corresponded. She doesn't speak of women informants, but this photo she took in Hong Kong Harbor shows a woman with her hand on the tiller of a small boat where Joanna and Lincoln explored Chinese harbors on their own as teenagers, enjoying a degree of freedom and intercultural education far removed from the life of a young ladies on shore. Joanna published three books of maritime folklore, the original Roll and Go in 1924, an expanded edition simply called Songs of American Sailormen in 1938, and Gangway, Sea Language Comes Ashore in 1945. A lifelong manuscript work of sea poetry and naval ballads remains unpublished in the archives of the Peabody Essex Museum, where Joanna donated it when her health would not permit her to continue her research. Joanna knew her seamanship and put it to good use. She organized Roll and Go not alphabetically or geographically, but in sections representing the function of each type of working song aboard ship. Of the short drag shanties, she writes, "These simple forms of the shanty were used where only a few strong pulls were needed, as in boarding tacks and sheets, bunting up a sail in furling, hauling out on the weather yardarm in reefing a topsail, or sweating up the halyards at the end of a long pull. In the latter process, the leading singer, or shantyman, with perhaps the second mate to help him, stood up and pulled on the leading part of the rope, the crew tallying on behind the lead block." Here, Gordon Grant brilliantly illustrates sweating up with the crew tallying on. A great favorite for sweating up was, "Boney was a warrior, way-ay-ya, a warrior, a terrier, Jean-Francois." Consecrated by usage to the sheeting home of the foresail is, "Way, haul, way, haul, haul, and sing together, way, haul, way, we'll haul away, Joe." And a venerable short drag shanty from the reign of Henry VIII with a stately melody is, "Haul on the bowlin', a bully ship's a-rollin', haul on the bowlin', the bowlin', haul!" Joanna writes that halyard shanties were used chiefly for the longer and heavier tasks aboard ship, such as hoisting sail, catting the anchor, etc. They are quite regular in form, usually written in common time, with a solo line followed by a chorus of the same length. Two solo lines and two chorus lines make up the stanza. Sometimes the chorus provided for two pulls on the rope, generally, however, for only one. Many of the halyard shanties were used in pumping ship, and sometimes they are used to put life into the crew when tramping round the capstan, though for this use, the more elaborate windlass shanties were more common. We'll talk about capstan and windlass shanties in the next section.
"Now, men! Are you sailors? Or carpses? Or what are you? Ain't there shantymen among the whole blame crowd of you?"
To which the shantyman would answer back, "I'm a deep water sailor just come from Hong Kong to be way below the man down. If you give me some whiskey, I'll sing you a song. Give me some time to blow the man down."
One of Joanna's sources remembers hearing this one in the Guano Islands of the South Pacific.
"Fare you well now, Juliana, shallow, shallow brown, for you know I'm bound to leave you, shallow, shallow brown."
And a fascinating ritual shanty is poor old man or poor old horse on British ships. In Gangway, Sea Language Comes Ashore, Joanna tells us that the dead horse is an effigy thrown overboard when 1 month out with suitable ceremonies. It celebrates the working off of 1 month's advance wages received by the crew when signing the articles, and usually promptly confiscated by the boarding house keeper, see crimp or land shark, for alleged back debts. In shore speech, it means paying off any sort of debt. I sang this one when I wrote the final check on my student loan. They say, old man, your horse will die, and they say so, and they know so. They say, old man, your horse will die, oh, poor old man. Joanna makes a clear distinction in her description of windlass and capstan shanties. Not for intermittent operations like pulling and hauling were the songs in this third class used, but for a continuous process. In hoisting anchor, warping ship, etc., the rope or cable was wound around the barrel of the capstan, and the men walked steadily round and round it, pushing the capstan bars before them. It follows that any song with a long chorus and a swing to it was likely to go well as a capstan shanty. Some of the halyard shanties already given were used in this way, and some of the forecastle songs that follow in the next section. We've had Rio Grande at the start of this program, well called the grandest of them all. Another that's well known in my home port of Boston is Cape Cod girls don't use no combs, heave away, haul away. They comb their hair with the codfish bones and we're bound away for Australia. And a fine homeward bounder is one more day, my Johnnies, one more day. Oh, rock and roll me over one more day. I love to imagine little Joanna as a stealthy audience in the forecastle. She clearly knew her scene. When the day's work was over, supper eaten, and the mess kits put away, and the pipes or cheeks, as the case might be, filled with strong plug tobacco, came the sailor's time of leisure. During the dog watch, in the early evening, both watches were on deck, gathered about the main hatch in pleasant weather, or stowed away in sheltered spots when it was inclement. Singing, dancing, and yarn spinning were then the order of the day. Cherished instruments were brought out, perhaps a squeaky fiddle, or an accordion, beloved of the sailor, and hated, for some unknown reason, by every master mariner I ever knew. Joanna began her work by reviewing published and unpublished collections of sea shanties. She corresponded with maritime and folk music scholars. She researched in archives and interviewed old sailors. Her project took her to Boston, New Bedford, Salem, and Sailor's Snug Harbor on Staten Island. But the beating heart of her collection is her family's experience at sea, listening to and learning from real shanty singers at work aboard ship. Joanna challenged herself in many ways in making this collection, including teaching herself musical notation so she could take down songs from sailors' lips without benefit of recording technology. I have transcribed the Colcord collection note for note as ABC, generating MIDI and MP3 recordings for scholars who are not sight singers looking to go back to the source. We can learn a great deal from Joanna's notation. Most tunes are hand-notated, especially in Roll and Go, while later tunes from other sources are in printed notation. She uses very short staff lines, 2 to 4 measures, with eighth notes and no beams as a bass rhythm. There's a broad mix of natural, sharp, and flat keys, and interestingly, most keys are singable by an alto or tenor. Chords are given for every song, but John Roberts reports that these are most likely added by the publisher and should be suspect given so many references to singing a cappella. There are no dynamic markings, but lots of slurs, fermatas, tenuto, marcato, triplets, broken rhythms, exclamation points, and other markings. Joanna was trying to communicate what she heard aboard ship and taught herself notation because she had so much to convey. Let's have one quick listen to the bar on when a new shanty was being formed. Two ships lying side by side. The English heard the German tune, said, "Gor blimey, but that's a dandy," and set their horns. Let's listen to the German original. Joanna actually minored in German and spoke it fluently. And then the shanty version, this one taken from Stan Hugel, who had it to Brooklyn. and let's translate that to this.
For the Spanish main we are bound away, all wrong. For the Spanish main we are bound away, all wrong. We are sailing away at the break of day, with a swift bonita and dolphin to play. Oh, roll, rocker, buzz. For the Spanish main we are bound.
Next, let's look at Joanna's career ashore and her strengths and weaknesses as a collector. While one of Joanna's strengths as a collector was her deep knowledge of the subject matter, another was her remarkable scholarly and educational ability. She majored in chemistry with her minor in German and completed a Master of Science in Biochem from the University of Maine at Orono in 2 years, 1907 to 1909. After her graduate work, she taught in a rural school, but found herself restless and dissatisfied with life as a teacher and frustrated by the lack of opportunity as a woman in applied science. Her German professor urged her to follow him into the new profession of social work, and she took a degree with him the following year in the New York School of Philanthropy. This led to a rewarding career as a social worker between the Great Depression and the Second World War. Joanna's specialty quickly became social service, and her career blossomed. She published her first book on broken homes in 1919, established schools and nursing stations in the Virgin Islands with the American Red Cross, and returned to New York to lead the charity organization division of the Russell Sage Foundation. There she administered FDR's New Deal funding and published another book on emergency work relief. Her employers at the Russell Sage Foundation said that experience with gales and hurricanes and the need to change course in heavy weather was a useful background for piloting her department through a tumultuous 15 years. Joanna had debated marriage earlier in her life, but found an old friendship ripening into love in her latter years. On Thanksgiving Day, 1950, in Bangor, Maine, Joanna Colcord, 68, married distinguished social worker and educator Frank J. Bruno, then 74, whose first wife had died 6 months earlier. Close friends for many years, their professional careers and lives had touched at many points. She said of him, "Frank was my guiding light, the summer of my heart, ever since I first met him years ago." Joanna Colcord stands alone among collectors as the first collector of the distinctively American songs of the sailormen she knew and loved. She had a fine scholarly bent and cites Wall, Bullen, Rickaby, Sharp, and Laura Alexandrine Smith, all English collectors whom she references in depth, especially in the 1938 edition. She was a peer of John Masefield and Cicely Fox Smith, as we've mentioned, and a primary source for Stan Hugel, Bill Derflinger, and Alan Lomax in their turn. Hugel references her 55 times in Chanteys from the Seven Seas and pulls his forelock to her with great respect. Miss Colcord is a woman, but a regular seaman if ever there was one. Joanna's work is dedicated to the memory of her father, Master Mariner Lincoln Alden Colcord, who was the last generation of singing sailors. He went into steam in the early years of the new century, but in the corporate world of the steamship companies, there was no room for a shipboard family or ultimately a man who was master of his own vessel and leader of her crew. Joanna took this photo of him when she was 18, on one of their last voyages in the China trade. The final words of Roland Goh could have been written for him, and probably were. "And with this, we bid farewell to the singing sailor. He went his way with the ships he loved and served. No roadstead resounds anymore with Santiana or Rio Grande, while the men tramp round the capstan and the cable clanks into the lockers under their feet. No yards rise swaying to the tune of Whiskey Johnny, nor does the invocation to Paddy Doyle aid bleeding fingers to furl the steel-hard canvas as the ship goes plunging through a Cape Horn night. Autre temps, autre mœurs. And steam asks no help from song. The ships have gone and the men left the employ. But a nation which has come to value its maritime history and traditions should not forget these songs, rude and artless though they may be, for they were a living part of the glory of the days of sail." Steam asks no help from song. These songs very nearly died out in the generation that followed Captain Colcord. But thanks in large measure to Stan Hugel, the self-described last shantyman, a folk revival of these songs kept the glory days of sail alive and singing in the shanty circles at pubs, clubs, and festivals. 40 years ago, I learned most of the airs to Colcord songs in this oral tradition and delved into the printed collections for details and lyrics. Today's singers trade recordings, so for this project I started a playlist on Spotify to track who had recorded what from the Colcord collection. I was delighted to find that apart from a dozen or two fragments, songs missing airs, or uncomfortable lyrics, I was able to find the vast majority of Colcord's collection recorded on Spotify. Over 150 versions of well over 100 songs from this seminal collection. There are classic versions from A.L. Lloyd and Stan Hugel, modern renditions by Nathan Lane and his TikTok buddies, and even some punk rock and metal versions. With the notable exceptions of Eliza Carthy, Felicia Dale, Celtic Woman, and myself, recording artists of this material are remarkably male. Clearly it's time for a new recording project, which is in the works. Joanna herself struggled with questions of gender for publication, especially with this material. As an aside, it's worth noting that a generation later, Stan Hugel himself declined to publish a collection of bawdy sea songs with the concern that it would limit future opportunities for publishing his work. When Joanna proposed to follow in the tradition of W.B. Hwall, L.A. Smith, and C. Fox Smith, her brother Lincoln took her to task. And now I sit me down to complain of your decision and your arguments as to the way your name is to stand on the title page. Neither are worthy of you, Nan. You deliberately propose to dodge your sex for obscure psychological reasons. Not a reason you give will hold water for a minute. There is no objection at all to having a woman collect a volume of sea poetry. No reader would raise a question about it for a moment. There is no objection to a woman's having been to sea. It only adds to the interest of the occasion. Here is something new, a real sailor woman. You have a good right to your sailor knowledge, and I am proud of it whenever I think of you. You ought to glory in it and make all the capital there is of it. 100 years later, Joanna has indeed made capital of it, and we can glory in her work as a real sailor woman. If I were there with you in person, I'd ask you to say this with me, so let's say it together. There is no objection to a woman's having been to sea. It only adds to the interest of the occasion. And that's the Flying Cloud, built in the yard of Donald McKay in Boston, who had a woman navigator, Eleanor Creasy. She set a record round the horn to San Francisco in 1851 and broke it herself in 1854. That record stood till 1989. There is great interest in the occasion of a woman's having been to sea. I thank you for sharing it. And I thank you for helping celebrate the centennial of Roll and Go, a seminal collection by any measure. We have Lincoln Colcord again to thank for reminding us that the book is a fieldwork. In the truest sense of the word, it is an authority, enough to say that it would have passed muster among shanty-singing seamen. If you'd like to ship aboard the centennial tour for Roll and Go, I have a number of in-person and hybrid appearances coming up this year, including the National Conference of the American Folklife Society in November. I look forward to bringing sea shanties to the American Southwest. I'm also booking additional online programs and would be glad to talk further. You can reach me for questions at info@linhole.com or just scan this barcode to go directly to www.joannacolcord.com, which includes video, downloadable music files, playlists, and lots of other program materials that we didn't get a chance to cover here. I'm very sorry not to meet you all in person, but I will be at Sidmouth Folk Week in a few weeks, and you'll find me on the compere's bench in the middle bar of the Anchor Inn. Come sing us a chantey and let's talk about collectors. Thank you all for your time and attention.